very much. Is that your order, sir? I don't have any pretty pictures on my predecessor, which I apologise. But on the other hand, I don't think I can think of any pretty pictures that I would have put up, so that's probably just as well. Because if I put up pictures of the kind of things I'm going to talk about, they would look incredibly boring. And this is the first point that I want to make. It's great that you're all interested in this subject. It is extraordinarily difficult to find as many people as there ought to be who are interested. It's extraordinary given the fact that for most of our politicians, the places that they live in and the shape and the feel of them are amongst the most important aspects of their lives. But when you are not talking about what is going on in a particular place at a particular time, but are talking about the rules that give rise to much of what actually happens in a particular place at a particular time, suddenly the entire nation switches off and goes into doze and snore mood. This is evident in all sorts of ways, but I brought your attention in particular the so-called local plan. The local plan in each locality, even today, has been something of some considerable importance. But I challenge you to walk out of this splendid building on the site of the old market and walk around the town trying to find somebody who isn't involved in the planning system, who has the slightest idea what the local plan says, unless they are literally engaged in some activity to do with their own place just now. And I very much doubt that anyone here would be able to find anyone out there who could answer positively what was in their local plan. And that's just one tiny symptom of the general problem, which is that where the previous speaker was speaking out quite eloquently and rightly about empowerment, what we actually have is a system in which, over a very long time, our fellow citizens have been, and have as a result, because they're not stupid, felt disempowered when it came to taking charge of what the place that they live in is like. And the sorry history of how that came about has yet, I think, properly to be written. But broadly, the lines of it, I think, are pretty clear. For many hundreds of years, there was no such thing as planning. People built what they built. And much of it, by the way, was incredibly beautiful and appropriate. If you want to make yourself cry, you should look at the engravings of what the City of London looked like from a bridge, like the bridge that Wordsworth stood on when he wrote Poems at Home, but a couple of hundred years earlier. It was something like what Florence looks like today. That wasn't planned, nobody designed it, except some geniuses like Wren, and yet it grew up in the most spectacularly lovely way. And similarly, many of our villages and many of our country towns, and indeed some of the great cities of the 18th and 19th centuries. Manchester, for example, was a fantastic edifice. In 1880. And none of these things were planned. They were done, and they were typically done by people that were in charge of their own place. The cities, of course, had an extraordinarily strong tradition of civic government, and the villages were formed by some kind of combination of the landowners and the negotiation that they currently had with the people living on their land. And then we all know the next phrase, which is that sometime around the turn of the century, that's to say the turn of the 19th and 20th centuries, apart from what I would describe as a pretty widespread beginning of a collapse of taste in financial side. The other thing that happened was that development got going as a mass phenomenon. Some of it done by governments, vast amounts of tearing down and building, some of it by local governments, some of it by capitalists. Wherever and whatever it was done by, it began to threaten a huge part of the heritage. And rather late in the day, long after the spoliation of, for example, the city of London had largely occurred, the nation woke up somewhere around the middle of the last century and thought to itself, this is no good. We must put some limits around it. And a system which is called a planning system arose. It was a misnomer. Now, what it actually is a system of development control. It's an effort to hold back the tide of philistinism. Environmental, ecological philistinism, and design philistinism, and many other kinds of philistinism into the bargain, including the destruction of public open spaces and much else. And there's just one problem with the system of development control, which is that in the classical English way, this became highly formalized, stylized, dialectical, legalistic process. Rather beautiful in its own way. I once heard a planning silk describe planning law as the most elegant and beautiful creation in our legal system. And I suppose in a certain sense it is, if what you're interested in is the extraordinarily arcane way in which definitions and interactions occur. But if you're interested in results, it's very far from beautiful. Because what it did was to lead people to think that they had no control, there were controls outside, and the kinds of places that they lived in, they could have very little influence in. And they discovered, incidentally, that there was just one thing they could do, which was to buy the metaphorical machine guns of democracy, agitate, and oppose. And people got very good at this, I think, in many places. Indeed, they got to so good that successive governments, this is not a partisan, but it's been true of governments of all parties, successive governments got incredibly frustrated because the machine gun rest has been set up and were repeatedly set up by the locals to stop somebody else doing something to the place they lived in which they didn't have any real control over, was to step in and try to counteract the development control which they themselves were sponsoring with a series of commands, edicts, sentences, and so forth, to push the bodies, laughably called planning committees, which are actually development control committees, not to do so much development control, so that more still, so that people had some houses which they needed. This, of course, made the locals yet more furious, yet more machine gunners to set up. And there's another remarkable result of all this, which I suspect that in this room knows, little known to most of our fellow citizens, which is that if you are Mrs. Jones and you are trying to add a little bit to your house in a way that none of your neighbours object, your chance of being able to do something is minimal. Whereas if you are Mr. AM developer, with planning service and consultants by the dozen and the bottomless purse, your chance of being able to build something incredibly ugly, inappropriate, and much despised is enormously high. But after a very long time, with great suspense, so that the houses are then unaffordable. Looked at from this historical perspective, it has to be said that it's very difficult to determine why anyone would have wanted to do these things. And the answer is they didn't. It's just a series of mishaps. I can't find anywhere in the literature anyone who set out a grand vision that things should be like what they are in 2010, 2011. They just sort of come to be this way. And this is what the coalition government is now trying to do something about. We're trying to change the whole of that dynamic. Now, none of this is under the misapprehension that we can do entirely overnight. This is a vast cultural shift that we're trying to achieve, and it's one that will take a considerable period to be fulfilled. If indeed the whole venture succeeds, as I know, I'm down to you, it will. And when I say a considerable time, I mean decades, not years. And what we are trying to do is essentially to change the underlying dynamic. And there's a leap of faith, which is the starting point. And the leap of faith is that if people in each locality, and I mean really each locality, a neighborhood, so in rural terms, a village or a market town, the place that people would describe themselves as coming from, or in urban terms, the housing estate, or the set of terraces, the little area that thinks of itself as an neighborhood. Most challengingly, actually, in the suburbs, the place as it's defined by the locals as a place, and that varies very much from suburb to suburb and place to place. But the idea is taking those local units to give the people who live in each of them the sense, not as a matter of advertisement, but as a matter of reality, that they have the power at last to take charge of what happens there, of what it looks and feels like increasingly over the years to come. Now, of course, we do not live in a Soviet system, thank goodness, and therefore it is not possible for the locals to decide to dispoliate and dispossess, not move in and knock down the houses of those currently living there. I'm not suggesting that they should be able to nationalize and eject. So this is inevitably entirely an incremental process. It's not a question of undoing everything that is the case, but of determining the shape of what is done thereafter. But of course, look at across the perspective of many decades and eventually centuries, what starts off as increment becomes stock to a very great extent. So we really are trying to give people the power over time to determine the shape and feel of the places that they live in. And before I move on and describe somewhat how we see that happening and why we think it might work, I should just observe that this wholly radical thought, which I think still is regarded in very many quarters as entirely naive, romantic, and impossible, is in fact commonplace in many other parts of Europe. Sitting at meetings with people who are doing this on an absolutely regular basis, for example in the Netherlands, they are wholly unable to imagine how you could possibly have a system like ours. So we shouldn't be trapped into supposing that there is in fact anything very radical about what I'm describing. It's just a radical shift away from a situation which has arisen historically as it happens in Britain, England, which needn't be so, isn't so in other places, and can be shaped.